I want to invite you to open your Bibles with me today to Matthew's Gospel, chapter 2, please, the second chapter of the Gospel of Matthew. And we are going to begin reading in a moment in verse number 7. Matthew's Gospel, chapter number 2. I do not know this to be a fact, but I really believe it from the scholars who say this, but the scholars tell us that there are over 700 different names and titles for the Lord Jesus Christ that we find in the Bible. Over 700 different names and titles. Evidently, the Lord Jesus is so mighty and so great in His person and in His work that it takes hundreds of names and hundreds of titles just to describe Him. And I think one of the great joys of the Christian life is to do a study on the names of Jesus and understand them, because every name that He wears is a blessing that He shares. And the more that we understand the names and the titles of Jesus, the more that we know Him. And the more that we know Him, the more that we know about who He is, what He has done for us, what He is going to do for us, and what He does for us in the present. We have been in a little series during this Christmas season on the words of Christmas. And we have been looking at some of the various words that we find in the Christmas story. Today I want to look at one of those words that really is not a very familiar word at all, and it's the word Nazarene. And I want to talk about Jesus the Nazarene. I've never heard a sermon preached on Jesus the Nazarene. And yet I believe that here is a title and a name for Jesus that is filled with great meaning that will help us presently in our walk with the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, this name Nazarene does not appear until the end of the Christmas story, and yet it is a vital part of us understanding who this Jesus is who came to save us from our sins. I want to invite you to look in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 2, beginning with verse number 7. And I want to read quite a few of these verses this morning. But verse number 7 says, "Then Herod, when he had secretly called the wise men, he determined from them what time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem, and he said, 'Go and search carefully for the young child. When you have found him, bring word to me that I may come and worship him also.'" Every time I read him saying that, I want to say, yeah, right. "And when they heard the king, they departed, and behold, the star, which he had seen in the east, went before them till it came and it stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented gifts to him, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And then being divinely warned in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed for their own country another way. Now when they had departed, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream, saying, 'Arise, take the young child and his mother, flee to Egypt, and stay there until I bring you word. For Herod will seek the young child to destroy him.' And when he arose, he took the young child and his mother by night and departed for Egypt, and was there until the death of Herod, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, 'Out of Egypt I called my son.' Then Herod, when he saw that he was deceived by the wise men, was exceedingly angry, and he sent forth and he put to death all of the male children that were in Bethlehem and all of its districts from 2 years old and under, and according to the time which he had determined from the wise men. And then was fulfilled what was spoken by Jeremiah the prophet, saying, 'A voice was heard in Ramah, lamentation, weeping, and great mourning. Rachel weeping for her children, refusing to be comforted because they are no more.' Now when Herod was dead, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt, saying, 'Arise, take the young child and his mother, and go to the land of Israel, for those who sought the young child's life are dead.' Then he arose, he took the young child and his mother, came into the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus was reigning over Judea instead of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. And being warned of God in a dream, he turned aside into the region of Galilee. And here is our real verse for the day. And he came and he dwelt in a city called Nazareth, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophets, he shall be called a Nazarene. When Joseph and Mary brought the child Jesus back to Israel from Egypt, we read that God had warned Joseph in a dream not to settle in Judea, but rather to return to their home native town of Nazareth in Galilee, which was about 70 miles from Jerusalem. And excavations over the years have revealed that Nazareth was not a large city at all. In fact, it was a little humble town of fewer than 500 people. And there are 25 references to Nazareth in the New Testament, and the word Nazarene is a word that is found only 6 times. We know that Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, but the people did not identify him with Bethlehem. Instead, they identified him with Nazareth in Galilee. It was in Nazareth that he spent most of his earthly life. We know that at the age of 30, when he began his public ministry, we know that he left Nazareth and he began to travel throughout various parts of the Holy Land, preaching the gospel and healing the sick and raising the dead, and on I could go. But because he grew up in Nazareth, the people referred to him as Jesus of Nazareth, or Jesus the Nazarene. And the question I want to ask and try to answer is, what do we learn about Jesus being identified as Jesus the Nazarene, or the one who was from Nazareth? There are several things I think that we learn, and first of all, we learn a past fact. And the past fact that we learn that is a very important fact is that Jesus Christ was a real person from a real place. He was a real historical person that lived in a real historical place. We are told in Luke's Gospel, chapter 2 and verse 21, that both his birth and his name, they were registered in Nazareth. And the people, they knew his parents, they knew his brothers and sisters. In fact, if you would have traveled to Nazareth in that day, and you would have said there is no such person as Jesus who has ever lived, they would have laughed you out of town. Because you see, they saw Jesus grow up. They saw him when he was a child. They saw him working in his father's carpenter shop. They saw him as he played with the other children. And no doubt they would have told you that, yeah, there was a person here by the name of Jesus, but he left when he was about 30 years of age, and rumor is that he was baptized by that famous guy whose name was John the Baptist. They probably would have told you that word on the street is that he has become an itinerant teacher of spiritual things. And no doubt they would have told you about that time that Jesus returned to Nazareth and he walked into the synagogue and he taught there in the place that he had attended for most of his life. They would have told you about that, I'm sure, because that was the day that the people in the city of Nazareth began to realize that this man was not just some ordinary Jewish boy that grew up in Nazareth. I think they would have reminded us of what happened in Luke chapter 4, verse 14 through 18, where the Bible says, "Then Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit to Galilee. News of him went out through all the surrounding region. And he taught in their synagogues, being glorified by all. So he came back to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And as his custom was, he went in the synagogue on the Sabbath day, and he stood up to read. And he was handed the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he opened the book, he found the place where it was written, 'The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of the sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord.'" And that message that was given to Jesus that he was to proclaim had everything to do with the place he was from that I'm going to show you, which was Nazareth. Now, friend, I bring all of this out to point out that the Christian faith is a faith that is grounded in solid historical events, including the life of Jesus of Nazareth, his death, his burial, his resurrection, and his ascension. You see, these events, given the fact that they are a historical fact, are important because these events form the foundation of the gospel in which we believe, that gospel that saves us from our sins. And when you and I place our faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, we are not simply grasping at some nebulous thing, but we are putting our faith in well-documented facts. There was a man named Jesus who lived in a literal place that was called Nazareth. And so to deny Jesus is to deny history. Friend, our faith is grounded in solid historical evidence. And so the first thing that we learn then is a past fact. But the second thing that we learn from this statement, Jesus the Nazarene, is a puzzling statement. The puzzling statement is found in verse number 23, and the puzzling statement is not that he shall be called a Nazarene, but the puzzling statement is that it was spoken by the prophets. Now, why is this such a puzzling statement? I'll bet you that you have never seen this before, because there is no one prophecy in any Old Testament prophetic book where we find this statement, that Jesus would be called the Nazarene. And yet here we see very clearly the Bible says that it was spoken by the prophets. But there's nowhere we can turn and find where it was spoken by any prophet. And so there are some who would say, there is proof. There are errors in the Bible. And I would say, hold on just a minute. There are some who say that here is a prophecy that was spoken, and yet evidently it was lost through the years, so it's not recorded in the Scripture. Well, if we believe that, those of us who believe in the inerrancy and the inspiration of Scripture, then we really do have a problem. Because what that means is that here was a prophecy that was spoken, and yet it was not preserved by the Holy Spirit and gotten into the inspired Word of God like the Holy Spirit did every other inspired Word from God. And then there are those who would say, well, what this must mean is that here was a prophecy that was spoken, but it was not written. But now we have a problem contextually with that, because there are two other prophecies that are mentioned in this context that were spoken, but they also were written. Down in verse 15, and was there until the death of Herod, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, out of Egypt I have called my son. And that was written in Hosea chapter 11 and verse number 1. Down in verse number 17 again, then was fulfilled what was spoken by the prophet, saying, in verse 18 he gives us the prophecy, and we find that that was written in Jeremiah 31, verse number 15. So evidently, if this prophecy was spoken by the prophets, as is pointed out in verse 23, then it would have to be written somewhere. So it's a puzzling statement. So let me see if I can do two things. Number one, talk a little bit about the meaning. What is meant by this statement that it was written by the prophets that Jesus shall be called the Nazarene? Now, friend, we cannot relate the word Nazarene with the word Nazarite. There are those that have tried to do that and say, well, he was saying that Jesus would be a Nazarite like John the Baptist, but that could not be because Jesus did not meet the requirements of a Nazarite. We know that Jesus touched dead bodies. Nazarites didn't. We know that Jesus drank from the fruit of the vine. Nazarites didn't. And so he could not be relating that word then, Nazarene, to being a Nazarite. There are also those that would say that, well, the word Nazareth, that comes from the word netzer, that means branch or root. That's what he was talking about. And certainly there are prophecies that speak about Jesus being a branch or a root. Isaiah 53, verses 1 and 2, they do that. But that's not what he's talking about. because it's a completely different Hebrew word for the word that is used for netzer. And so what in the world is the meaning of this? Now, I can tell by looking on your faces, some of you say, what is the big deal? Well, I'm about to show you. I think the real meaning here is found in the word that he uses for prophets. It is a plural. It's prophets. It's not singular, prophet. So prophets, plural. And friend, when we take and put together all of the Old Testament prophecies about what all of the Old Testament prophets said about Jesus, man, this makes perfect sense. He's not talking about one prophet, a specific prophet mentioning one prophecy. There were those that did that. There were singular prophets that talked about Jesus, the place of his birth, the how of his birth. He would be born of a virgin, the lineage of his birth. But he says, here is something that all of the prophets, all of them spoke about. And friend, when you take all of that that's mentioned about Jesus that was written by all of the prophets, what is the one thing that all of the prophets say about Jesus? They say that he would be despised and he would be rejected of men. That was the consistent theme of all of the prophecies about him. Let me just give you a few. Over in Psalm 22, for example, verses 6 through 8, Jesus here says, I am a worm, no man, a reproach of men, despised by the people. All those who see me, they ridicule me. They shoot out the lip. They shake the head, saying, he trusted the Lord. Let him rescue him. Let him deliver him if he delights in him. Verse number 13 of that same psalm. They gape at me with their mouths like a raging and a roaring lion. Psalm 69, verses 8 and 9. Listen to this prophecy about Jesus. I have become a stranger to my brothers and an alien to my mother's children because zeal for your house has eaten me up and the reproaches of those who reproach you have fallen on me. Verse 19, you know my reproach, my shame, and my dishonor. My adversaries are all before you. Reproach has broken my heart. And I'm full of heaviness. I look for someone to take pity, but there was none. And for comforters, but I found none. They also gave me gall for food, and for thirst they gave me vinegar to drink. And I could go over to Isaiah 52 and Isaiah 53 and show you where the prophet Isaiah talked about Jesus, that he would be despised. And he would be rejected by the majority of the people. And he would be looked at and he would be considered a reproach. And we see this in all of the Old Testament symbols. We see it, for example, in the symbol of the Passover lamb. We see it, for example, in the symbol of the uplifted servant. And friend, when you and I think about this, this is counterintuitive to the way that we would think about someone and the way that they would come and the way that they would be viewed, who came of such a royal birth. And yet this is how the world saw the Son of the living God. So I believe that's the meaning. This is what was written by the prophets. And it is recorded over and over and over again that he would be despised and he would be rejected by the majority of the people. And the very fact of the place where he grew up puts an extra added emphasis upon that. And I really think that when we begin to meditate on this meaning written by the prophets, it gives to us the real message of what is being communicated in this part of the Christmas story. What does it mean for us today? Well, friend, we have to go back and we have to remember what Nazareth meant in that day. What did people think about? If I walked up to someone and I said, I am Craig Connor, the Nazarene, because I'm from Nazareth, what would they think about that? Remember when Philip was converted? And Philip came to get his friend Nathanael and introduce him to Jesus? And remember what Nathanael said? Nathanael said of Jesus, can any good thing come out of Nazareth? Why did Nathanael say that? because of what the people thought about Nazareth. What did they think about Nazareth? Man, they thought that was a despised and a rejected place. That's a lowly place. That is a place on the other side of the tracks. That is the place that anybody that's from there, a Nazarene, they are not written in anybody's who's who. That's what they thought about when Jesus said he was Jesus the Nazarene. And I really believe the one great, glorious, and grand message that is communicated by that title for Jesus is the grace of God. You see, when Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, when he invaded human history, friend, he didn't identify with Jerusalem, the great city of religion. He didn't identify with Rome, the great city of law. He didn't identify with Athens, the great city of philosophy. He identified with Nazareth, the despised place, the rejected place, the place where the poor and the needy and the heartbroken, the place that was a mixed multitude of both Jews and Gentiles, the despised lived there. And what Jesus was saying is, I identify with the worst of the worst, the neediest of the needy, the poorest of the poor. And I can take that which the world looks at as being the worst, and I can transform that into being something that is good. Friend, can any good thing come out of Nazareth or Hilliard or Southport or Callaway or Lynn Haven or Bay County? And I say, yes, 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 as long as they come out with Jesus. Because it doesn't matter how bad a person is, when they are touched by Jesus the Nazarene, I'm telling you, he can identify with them and who they are and where they've been, and he can transform them. And so Jesus came, and this blows my mind. He came bearing the name of a despised and a rejected place. During his stay on this planet for 33 and a half years, he bore reproach and suffering because of who he was and because of what he stood for. And this name of Jesus tells us that the call to the Christian life, are you listening? Say amen. Amen. The call to the Christian life is the call, listen, to share in the sufferings of Christ. The Apostle Paul said, I want to know him. And if that verse would have been written today, Philippians 3:10, it would have stopped at part A. It never went to part B. Paul said, I want to know him in the power of his resurrection, but also in the fellowship of his sufferings. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 13, the Bible says, therefore let us go to him who is outside the camp bearing his reproach. How were those early believers identified? Acts chapter 24, verse number 5, the Bible says, for we have found this man, that's Paul, a plague, a creator of dissension among all the Jews throughout the world. He is a ringleader of the sect of what? The Nazarenes. He was not ashamed to identify with Jesus Christ and to suffer for it. Dear friend, that's the call upon our lives from Jesus the Nazarene. We are not to be ashamed of the gospel of Christ. We are not to be ashamed to take up our cross and follow him. We are not to be ashamed to be identified with his cause. We are not to be ashamed to stand for what he stood for. See, that's the call of Jesus the Nazarene, is that we are willing to suffer along with him. But there is a third thing, and that from Jesus the Nazarene, that is a present example. A present example. Six times in Matthew's gospel, the Bible said Jesus did such and such in order to fulfill prophecy. He did this, why? In order to fulfill prophecy. He did this, why? In order to fulfill prophecy. Why did Jesus live in Nazareth? Because the Word of God told him to. Why was he born in Bethlehem? because the Word of God said that is where he was to be born. Over and over again in John's gospel, we read Jesus saying, I did this in order to please the Father. You know what we see by that example? We see a present example of how we are to live. How are we to live? We are to live obeying the Word of God. And friend, if we could just get it, friend, when we commit our lives to live in obedience to the Word of God, we are living like Jesus lived. And friend, that's where we find happiness. That's where we find peace. That's where we find real joy. Friend, this name magnifies the importance of living in obedience to the Word of God. But there is a third thing that we see that I just love, and that is a profound teaching. We see a profound teaching. The profound teaching that we see here really has a lot of meaning to me personally, because this profound teaching that we are about to see is the thing that God used to inspire the title for one of my books, Humiliation to Exaltation. And that is what we see in the name I'm going to show you, Jesus the Nazarene. 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 5 and 6, the Bible says, likewise, you younger people, submit yourselves to your elders. Yes, all of you be submissive to one another and be clothed with humility. For God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he might exalt you in due time. Humble yourself and God will exalt you. Do we realize how Jesus had to humble himself to allow the name Nazareth and Nazarene to be attached to his name? Remember, friends, the promise, humility leads to exaltation. And we see this being fleshed out in the life of Jesus the Nazarene by where Jesus took that name. Where did he take that name? He took that name to the cross. Do you remember when Jesus was crucified? The Bible says that when he was crucified, that Pilate hung a sign up over the cross. It was written in Hebrew, Greek, and Latin. And what did that sign say? Jesus the Nazarene, King of the Jews. And what happened at the cross? When was Jesus glorified? When he was crucified. The place of shame became the place of exaltation. And that is why Galatians 6:14 means so much to us when it says that we glory in the cross. When we humble ourselves and say, God, I am nothing but a worthless sinner. God, I am a sinner by birth. I'm a sinner by choice. God, I need a Savior. When we humble ourselves before God and we admit that, we are born again, and at that point, we are exalted. You see, dear friends, humility comes before exaltation. But did you know what? Jesus didn't just simply take that name to the cross. He took it even higher. He took that name with him to heaven. Do you remember when the Apostle Paul was confronted by Jesus? How did Jesus identify himself to the Apostle Paul? Listen in Acts chapter 22, verse 6. Paul said, now it happened as I journeyed and I came near Damascus at about noon, suddenly a great light from heaven shone round about me, and I fell to the ground, and I heard a voice saying, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Paul says, so I answered, and I said, who are you, Lord? And he said to me, I am Jesus of Nazareth. Wow. Remember what that name portrays? The grace of God. What did Paul need at that moment? What had he been doing? He had been putting Christians in prison. He had been having them executed. And why did Jesus reveal himself to Paul like that? Because Paul understood what the Nazarene meant. And what he needed was grace. And friends, what he got was grace. I tell you, as I came to discover this past week in my study, I had a Baptist fit right there behind my desk. I said, wow. Of all the names Jesus could have took with him to heaven, he took this one. Why? Because nothing makes Jesus more happy than extending grace. Nothing. Friend, there's a warped, mixed up theology today that says God is glorified when people go to hell because he is praised for his justice. I don't believe that. I think God is praised for his grace. And when he extends grace, like he wants to extend grace, God is praised. God is worshiped. God is glorified. What blows my mind is to realize Jesus grew up in Nazareth. He was there for all those years, rubbing shoulders with people every day. And the vast majority wouldn't have anything to do with him. He passed by day after day after day. And the majority just rejected him. Friend, did you know Jesus is still passing by today? Every church this morning that's preaching the gospel, what's Jesus doing? He's passing by. One of my favorite hymn writers, the great Fanny Crosby, had a dream one night. She dreamed that Jesus came to her town. And in that dream, she saw Jesus passing by, touching people, calling people. And there she was in that dream, and she said she was crying out to Jesus, "Do not pass me by." And she wrote that great old hymn, "Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by." And so the people of Nazareth, where Jesus grew up, majority of them rejected him. Friend, I want to tell you, Jesus is passing by you this morning. Listen, if you need to be saved, he's passing by you as a Savior. If you need to be forgiven, he's passing by you as a forgiver. If you need to be healed, he's passing by you as a healer. If you need a miracle, he's passing by you as the miracle worker. Don't miss him today. Open up your life to him. Open up your heart to him. Jesus the Nazarene wants to come into your life. Would you stand, please? Heads bowed and eyes closed and no one looking around. If the Spirit of God's spoken to your heart in any way, perhaps for salvation, perhaps the need for church membership, perhaps the need just to pray, we invite you to come. Our ministerial staff will be standing down front, and they will be glad to help you in any way that they can. Father, thank you for this incredible title that you gave to our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you that he is such a Savior that can identify with us exactly where we are. in our time of need. And God, I pray that not anyone would leave this building today that needs Jesus. They would leave without Him. And I pray that You would be glorified as spiritual decisions are made this day. In Christ's name I pray. Heads are bowed and eyes closed.